Good morning, everyone, and let me please welcome you to the event today. The Jones Act 100, is it time to chart a new course? Beginning with a conversation with Senator Lee from Utah, and followed by a panel discussion. The Jones Act, signed into law on June 5th, 1920, will be 100 years old tomorrow. And parenthetically, Senator Lee is going to be a little bit older today. It's his birthday. Happy birthday, Senator.
Thank you.
For a century, the legislation has restricted competition for shipping goods by sea between any two US ports and some US territory ports by prohibiting any foreign flag vessel from participating in that trade. US shipping companies are allowed to carry those shipments, but even there, only on US vessels built in the country, crewed by US citizens, and owned by US companies, and registered under the US flag. The Jones Act is described by many economists and commentators as a prime example of legislation that panders to special interests, in particular US maritime shipping companies and shipbuilding companies, maritime unions, and rail and trucking companies, at considerable expense to US companies in other sectors of the economy, US workers in those sectors, and consumers in the form of higher prices for goods than would otherwise be the case. Critics also argue that the Jones Act, by incentivizing companies to ship cargo from sea to rail and truck, also has a substantial adverse effect both on the country's road and bridge infrastructure, as well as the environment. Proponents of the legislation, however, argue that the United States benefits from the Jones Act and related legislation because it ensures that the nation's armed forces have important access to sealift capacity in times of international crisis. A century after the passage of the Jones Act, this AI event examines the evidence about the legislation's impact on the US economy, the environment, the nation's military readiness, and therefore whether the legislation is an efficient or wasteful way of achieving national defense goals. Our event begins, as I mentioned, with an interview with Senator Mike Lee, who's been concerned about these issues for many years, and who has introduced and sponsored legislation to reform or terminate the Jones Act. The conversation with Senator Lee will be followed by a discussion of the issues by a distinguished panel of experts. Senator Lee has long been concerned about the efficient use of the nation's resources, and that's reflected in his current chairmanship of the Joint Economic Committee of Congress, as well as his service on the Senate Judiciary Committee as chair of the Subcommittee on Antitrust, Competition Policy, and Consumer Rights. Senator Lee, it is really a genuine pleasure to welcome you to AEI and to this event. Before we begin, I'd like to ask you briefly to share your perspective on the appropriate role of the federal government and Congress in relation to markets for specific commodities and services like shipping goods by sea between US ports and the ports of some US territories like Puerto Rico.
Thanks for the question and thanks for having me on. Yet, you correctly point out that it's my birthday today, and I'm turning 49, which means, as my friend Ted Cruz would tell me, I'm halfway to 98, which means I'm almost halfway to the 100-year mark that the Jones Act is celebrating. The Jones Act really has lived far too long, and it's time for us, as we would say in Utah, to release the Jones Act with a vote of thanks. That's Utah speak for thanks, but we don't want you anymore. Look, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 3 of the Constitution gives Congress the authority to regulate trade, or as we say in the Constitution itself, commerce, among and between the states with foreign nations and with the Indian tribes. The purpose of this, of course, was to prevent this sort of economic balkanization that was occurring under the Articles of Confederation prior to the adoption of the Constitution, wherein states were competing against each other. They were taxing and regulating each other's goods unfairly so as to disadvantage other states' economies. It's one of the reasons why the founders came together in Philadelphia in 1787 was to allow for all of that nonsense to end and to provide Congress, the sole federal lawmaking body, to have the power to regulate or make uniform the economic activity going on among and between the states with foreign nations and with Indian tribes. The plan was not there to shut down the free market, because the founding fathers understood, as we should understand better today than we do, that free market principles are essential to our survival as a nation. And so the Jones Act's stated purpose was to do whatever necessary to develop and encourage the maintenance of a merchant marine that could serve as a naval or military apparatus in any time of national emergency. So that's why they put it in there. Separate and apart from the question of whether the Jones Act policy on that front makes any sense as a whole, we have to note that there are troubling consequences to the policy that warrant our attention and that really make it necessary for us to revisit it. It's very concerning, for example, that we import energy products from geopolitical adversary nations like Venezuela and like Russia. Now, do we believe that consumers are harmed through price increases? Yes, absolutely. But it gets even worse when we realize that in places like New England, parts of New England and in Puerto Rico, people actually had to buy LNG from Venezuela and Puerto Rico. I believe from places like Venezuela and Russia. And in Puerto Rico—
Just a moment, so with apologies. LNG means liquid natural gas, right?
Yes, yes.
Sorry about that.
They've also purchased jet fuel from Venezuela. It's not because of a shortage of LNG or jet fuel in the United States. In fact, we're one of the best producers of both of those things. It is rather because there are only so many Jones Act compliant vessels capable of handling LNG shipments along coastlines. There are only a few hundred of those in the world who can do that. And yet not one of them happens to be U.S. flagged and U.S. crewed and U.S. built. So as a result of that, we've got to go to horrible regimes and enrich and further empower them as a result of this. We don't just empower bad regimes by doing that. We also further impoverish American citizens who have to pay higher prices on things that they buy. And it extends far beyond LNG and jet fuel. Everything they purchase becomes more expensive simply because of this protectionist law. It doesn't even really do what it was supposed to do.
So my follow-up question was going to be, what are your major reasons for having proposed legislation that would either end the Jones Act, which was one proposal, or modify it through providing fairly automatic waivers to its provisions in various circumstances? It's an inefficient way of going about things, it interferes with the operation of markets. And you've also said it quite bizarrely empowers some of the country's least comfortable relationships with countries like Russia and Venezuela. Beyond those issues, are there other concerns that you have?
Well, yeah, sure. It makes everything else more expensive. You speak to people in Hawaii. I was speaking to the Grassroots Institute in Hawaii a few years ago, discovered that consumers there, and they also mentioned Puerto Rico as being in a similar situation, all consumer products, things that people will buy at the grocery store from day to day, that tend to be either themselves imported and imported in a way that's dramatically affected by the Jones Act or affected by something else that in turn is. And so as a result, a lot of people are paying 10, 20, 30%, sometimes more on commonly accessed grocery items just as a result of this. So this is a classic example of a small handful of big wealthy corporations in America with concentrated benefits becoming further enriched on the backs of poor and middle-class Americans who are themselves relatively powerless and in many cases relatively unaware of the reasons why everything that they pay for has become so expensive. And people are convinced in many instances in places like Hawaii, in Puerto Rico and other places affected most severely by the Jones Act, that this is just a fact of life. They live in a remote location, so too bad. In many cases, they're discouraged from knowing or nobody's eager to tell them, hey, it's much worse than it has to be. Just because you live in a remote location doesn't necessarily mean things have to be this expensive, but there are a small handful of shipping companies getting very wealthy off of the additional dollars that you spend every single time you go to the grocery store. It was a really bad dynamic where you've got concentrated benefits and dispersed costs. And the dispersed costs are inflicted upon those who have relatively little bargaining power and relatively little ability to access the very information that they need to mobilize against those who are benefiting from this evil system.
Are the major costs mainly concentrated on places like Puerto Rico, Alaska, and Hawaii, or are there also other costs on every consumer in the United States?
No, there's no question. There are also other costs on every other American consumer. I mentioned places like New England, Alaska, Hawaii, and Puerto Rico, because that's where it has the most pronounced effect. But there's no question that the Jones Act also affects everybody else. Shipping itself is one of these things that is an input to all consumer products and all manufacturing products, for that matter, too. It affects everyone. And so when you have a limitation in place that affects how much it costs to get a product from point A to point B, everybody's paying more. It's difficult to quantify how much that affects everything, but that, to give you one data point, it costs something like 6 to 8 times more to build a ship that is Jones Act compliant than it does to build a non-Jones Act compliant ship. And so that's going to end up affecting everything. And it does. And here again, it's not really America's poor who are taking a free ride. It is predictably the wealthy and the well-connected who benefit from the Jones Act, while the poor and middle class pay the tab.
Given these insights about the costs of the Jones Act, what inhibited Congress from taking your legislation that you proposed last March to end the Jones Act? Can you talk a little bit about the forces that make getting rid of a costly piece of legislation for the community as a whole so difficult?
Sure. If you're familiar with the sugar market in the United States.
Oh, yes.
we've got a system of quotas and other price supports for a domestic industry. And that system of laws creates a very concentrated set of benefits held and enjoyed by a select few. Those few are able to pool their resources in such a way as to lobby very, very aggressively for policymakers here, for members of Congress. Even though everyone in the United States pays higher prices for sugar than they should have to, a small handful of people are getting really rich on this. So as a result of that, they harness that money and utilize it as lobbying power. And so inexplicably, even though most Americans would much prefer to pay a lower price for sugar, the higher price that they pay for sugar is just a little bit higher. And so nobody necessarily obsesses at the individual level over the higher price they pay for sugar. There are a small handful of us who find it irritating every time we have to buy sugar or something within it because we know it's more expensive. But most Americans don't worry about it that much because they're talking about maybe a few cents or a few dollars here or there. But there are a few people getting very, very rich off of this. It's the same thing with the Jones Act. Those who represent coastal states or those states where there are large ports or shipbuilding facilities, or even representing states where there are significant corporate interests that in some way or another benefit from the Jones Act, perhaps because they have a massive transportation company, and part of that involves investments in Jones Act compliance ships, even though their own state might be landlocked, they very often feel beholden toward those big wealthy interests. So it's that simple, it's that cynical. I don't like to be that cynical. Sometimes one cannot avoid it, and this is one of those times.
Well, it's a longstanding issue, I'm aware. Just briefly on the sugar program, back of the envelope estimates suggest that one family gain between $125 million and $200 million a year out of the sugar program. And you can fund a lot of lobbying that way, I'm sure. What can be done here to change the dynamic within Congress around this legislation and other pieces of legislation that affect consumers generally and other sectors of the economy, but particularly with the Jones Act?
Yeah. What I would like to happen, what really should happen, is we should pass the Open America's Waters Act. This is a complete repeal of the Jones Act that I originally worked on with the late Senator John McCain. We were motivated to repeal the Jones Act in its entirety due to the harm that this bad policy inflicts on our economy. After Senator McCain passed away, I've continued to work on the legislation. There are a number of reasons why that hasn't happened yet and why, sadly, the Jones Act remains current law. First, the Jones Act is now 100 years old. Tomorrow, it will literally be turning 100 years old. Even though we celebrate birthdays in this country with expressions of happiness like balloons and birthday cake, I'm trying to think of a Jones Act birthday celebration that would have much more unpleasant things. I'm going to work on that over the next 24 hours. Because a proper celebration of the Jones Act really would be something sad, depressing, abhorrent. Look, President Reagan would often say that if you want to start to try to understand what eternity looks like, what eternal life might be like, you should look at a government bureau. And in a similar manner, when laws become so entrenched in the economic framework of the political elite in America, they start to take on the trappings of immortality. This doesn't mean that these industries don't understand the arguments that you make and that we make about the deficiencies of the Jones Act and the disadvantages to the American people of having it. It just means that they can be resistant to change, given that the Jones Act has been such a formidable pillar in maritime law, and given that the Jones Act benefits so many people so significantly, we have to look at those drivers. Most importantly, I think we need to educate the American people about what it is and what it does. We're still at the point where most members of Congress, to say nothing about most Americans, but still most members of Congress, when you talk about the Jones Act, even those who are relatively informed on most issues are likely to look at you with a blank stare and say, let's pretend one of us doesn't know what that means. We need to be talking more about this one. Not just because this one in particular is important, but also because I think it's kind of a capstone. It encapsulates well everything that can go badly with law and public policy.
So the challenge is education to some extent, would you say?
Yeah.
And to some extent, pointing out who is winning and who is losing.
Yeah. Education, pointing out who is winning and who is losing. And if you look at almost any other context in public policy, we tend to win when we get large numbers of people, especially if we can get Democrats and Republicans together, talking about instances in which those who are economically and or politically disadvantaged, and chronically so, being unfairly treated by a law. The American people have an instinctive, almost intuitive ability to recognize unfairness. And once we see it, we're not very good at ignoring it as a people. Congress, yeah, we're great at it because it's what we do. But when Congress finally comes to understand that the American people are catching on to them and catching on to the fact that their members of Congress are perpetuating an inherently unfair, unjust regime, they start to do something about it. So we've got to send a message that the Jones Act is crony capitalism. The Jones Act is unfair. The Jones Act is hurting poor and middle-class Americans and doing so in order to enrich a small handful of really elite, well-connected, rich people.
So this is definitely not a left-right issue. This is a let's be common sense issue.
Yes, yes, that's right.
Apply common sense issue.
That's exactly right.
Let me ask you one final question, because I know you've got a busy schedule today. If in fact the you've suggested that the Jones Act does very little good for our military forces, and particularly the argument is often made by supporters of the Jones Act that it's essential to maintain sealift capacity, access to sealift capacity from the private sector mercantile marine. If that's not the case, what should be done to help the Navy have access to adequate sealift capacity and other armed forces?
Build ships. Build Navy ships. I mean, that's what we do. Our first job, our most important reason for existing as a federal government is to provide for our national defense. In my view, the most important way to do that is through the development and acquisition of equipment, particularly airplanes and ships. And I think the area where we are could do the most good, where we're perhaps most deficient in terms of our current equipment capacity, is with Navy ships. So if the problem is inadequate ships, well, let's not make the American consumer pay distorted prices, often to horrible regimes like those in Venezuela and in Russia. Let's just build more ships. We can do this. There are many critics inside the Pentagon who point out that we really are spending way too much money on personnel in that area. And when we try to compete with the personnel sizes on our military with places like Russia and China, who can basically conscript their military service member labor, we're never going to end up on the winning side of that equation. But we can outbuild them. We've got the strongest economy the world's ever known. We've got great manufacturing capacity. If what we need is more access to more military ships, let's build more military ships. Don't enrich a few people building commercial delivery vessels and call that a military effort. That's nonsense. It's a complete exaggeration on its own face. And it ignores what we need to be doing with our military, which is building more ships.
Senator Lee, thank you so much for sharing your views with us. I know you've got a busy day, and hopefully you'll find time for some cake and a good cup of coffee and some time to spend with your family. You have a wonderful day. It's your birthday. And thank you so much again for being with us.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I've decided that for the Jones Act's birthday, rather than have cake and ice cream for it, we're going to have a dumpster fire of sorts. I'll have to make sure I'm not violating any local ordinance at the time I do that. But what could be more fitting than a dumpster fire full of manure and in flames to represent the Jones Act?
Certainly, you never hold back in sharing your opinions. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let me now turn away from the Senator's comments, which are very provocative and really interesting, And let me now introduce our panel of experts who are going to discuss the Jones Act in different ways. Dr. Ann Krueger is the Senior Research Professor of International Economics at the Johns Hopkins School for Advanced International Studies. She is a past president of the American Economic Association and has been a leading thinker on international exchange issues and international economics. Well, for as long as I can recall, and I hope that's not an inappropriate comment for her, she's one of the most distinguished economists in the country. She not only worked in the academic academy, she's also worked in the harsher world of international organizations, and was the first deputy managing director at the International Monetary Fund, has been the vice president for economics and research at the World Bank, and has such a distinguished record. Our second panelist is Aaron Klein. Aaron is an economic studies fellow at the Brookings Institution and the policy director for the Center on Regulation of Markets. Previously, Dr. Klein served as the Deputy Assistant Secretary for Economic Policy and Policy Coordination at the US Treasury in the Obama administration, where he represented the administration on multiple interagency task forces, including the President's Task Force on Ports and the Committee on Maritime Transportation Systems. Mackenzie Eaglen is a colleague of mine at the American Enterprise Institute. She's resident fellow here at AEI in the Foreign and Defense Policy Department and a member of the US Army War College Board of Visitors. Ms. Eaglen served as the staff member of the congressionally mandated National Defense Strategy Commission in 2018. She has held positions in the United States House of Representatives, the Pentagon, the US Senate, and the US Senate, where she served as the principal advisor to Senator Susan Collins of Maine. Our final panelist is Rob Quartel. Mr. Quartel is the executive chairman of the board at Entelex. He has served as a member of the Federal Maritime Commission and has held positions at the Environmental Protection Agency, the Federal Energy Office, the Presidential Clemency Board, and the Army Science Board on Strategic Sealift. In the 1990s, Mr. Quartel led efforts to reform the Jones Act through the Reform Coalition. Thank you all for being here. We're going to begin this section of the event by asking each panelist to share their initial thoughts with us on the Jones Act. And we're going to begin by asking Dr. Krueger to share her concerns and insights. Dr. Krueger, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. And of course, it's a great pleasure to be here, even if it isn't in person, and to join this conversation. I guess my remarks will support those of Senator Lee. My only criticism of him would be that he is, if anything, not harsh enough on the Jones Act. It really is an unbelievable piece of work because I think there are many fewer beneficiaries than he does, and there are many more people who suffer in more ways. So I'm going to be trying to strengthen his case. He already mentioned the requirements for building ships in the, or for sea coastal ships in the US, having been US built and US manned and all that. But he did not continue to say that that has made the cost of building a ship in the United States some 4 to 6 times, maybe even 7 times, depending on the cost of the ship, what it is in other countries. So that if you do try to buy a ship here, it's very expensive. And that in turn has led to much older ships, even in maritime shipping here for that is done, than happens in, for example, Europe, which of course has a little bit of shipbuilding, but imports some ships, and that it happens in Asia, which is a much far cheaper source for many things. So one problem is that the maritime shipping fleet itself is old and high cost, which is only partly the fault of its owners and workmen. It is a fault, in fact, of the Jones Act and not otherwise. The result of which is that we have only 2 to 3 ocean-going vessels built in the US per year. Despite the fact that it is estimated that the useful economic life and safety life, if you like, of a ship is 20 years, more than two thirds of the Jones fleet is more than 30 years old, which makes it high cost. It also makes it inefficient, and it also does other things. Basically, we have other problems with it too. For example, the shipment of crude oil from the Gulf of Mexico to New England costs about $5 to $6. Shipment from the same origin, i.e. the Gulf of Mexico, to Canada, which is further away, is about $2. This was about 2005 or so. So it costs three times as much per barrel to ship the oil to a distance is arguably 25 or 30% less. This makes no sense. It's just charging because we don't have the appropriate equipment and we have the laws. The Senator Lee mentioned Hawaii. And yes, things are more costly there. They are so much more costly, believe it or not, that in fact, what happens is that sometimes cattle, i.e. Those that are going to market, are air freighted to the United States mainland rather than by sea because it's less expensive to air freight. Can you imagine when it's more, when it's cheaper and costs less to send cattle across the Pacific? It makes no sense whatsoever. But there's another set of costs, which is, amazes me, hasn't come up in all this, because there's a lot of evidence that seaborne shipping is cheaper on the environment, less costly to the environment, than is either trucking or rail. In particular, something like 10 to 40 grams of carbon dioxide per ton mile in the ocean of a seaborne vessel, ocean or otherwise. If you instead use rail, instead of being 10 to 40, it's 60 to 150. And for the rail, it's about the same rate, 20 to 250. In other words, our environment is messed up by using coastal shipping, both because we don't use more rail, or because we do more rail and we do more trucking because it is so expensive to go by sea. In the Europeans, you do about 40 to 60% of their inland transport by their rivers. Our river network is at least as good as theirs. We do about 5% of ours that way. The difference is, of course, because their shipping is much cheaper than ours because they have access to better costs. I'll finish by just saying that the survey done by the OECD found that the United States has the second most restrictive set of rules for maritime shipping of any OECD countries except Indonesia and China. Isn't that a good group to be in?
Well, difficult to say that it's a good group to be in. It's highly problematic. I have one quick follow-up question for you. In terms, you talked about how much more pollution there is when you move loads from sea to rail. What about moving from sea to truck? I'm guessing it's much worse.
It's even worse, no doubt about it.
Thank you, Anne. We now turn to Aaron Klein, and Aaron, I'm going to ask you to share your initial perspectives.
So there's a lot for me to react to. I'm in strenuous disagreement with most of what I've heard, and I have a limited amount of time. So let me just start at the beginning, because the Jones Act is not 100 years old, or put a different way, yes, this law is 100 years old. The concept of the law, which is called cabotage, is the oldest law in America. It is PL 1-2. So when Senator Lee talks about what our founding fathers believed in, this is the actual rare instance where we know what they believed in, because the law establishing the principle that the United States would serve its domestic transportation needs with domestic production was signed by George Washington. So the whole mumbo jumbo about the founding fathers and this or that and original constitutionalism is one of the worst arguments you can make with respect to cabotage, the economic principle that is globally adopted, as Ms. Krueger well knows, that countries serve their own domestic needs through their own transportation network. It is why you can't fly Emirates Air between New York and San Francisco. We have different cabotage rules on different types of transportation, but the concept is as old as this country. If you want to go against that, that's great. Maybe things that George Washington signed into law are bad ideas in the current situation. but you can't argue that it wasn't what our founding fathers believed in. One. Two, Senator Lee and others are proponents of giant military. Okay? They want 355 ships in the Navy, which is what the president has asked. You heard Senator Lee, build more ships. Well, that's a huge cost to American taxpayers. According to the Congressional Budget Office, the Navy's and the Trump administration's shipbuilding plan is something on the average of $865 billion of taxpayer-funded debt over 30 years. That's what Senator Lee wants to do. Spend on Navy ships. Now, why does it cost $865 billion to build this Navy fleet of his dream? If that's what America wants, if we want that many ships, a much cheaper way to do it is to support both domestic warship building and domestic peace shipbuilding. That's what America used to do when we subsidized our shipbuilding industry like the rest of the world. Because of the same philosophy against the Jones Act and against building US ships for commercial purposes, we abandoned that. In the 1950s and 60s, America made a third of the global shipping capacity. Today, we make a third of 1%. So we've gone from being one of the world powerhouses to being largely irrelevant, and the small, tiny remnants are basically to handle these few Jones Act required routes like Puerto Rico, Alaska, and Hawaii. Who's been the big winner on this? China. China is the big global shipbuilding. So we outsource American jobs to China so they can build the global ships that do a lot of commerce. And now in the very few areas where we want to have American ships, we want to replace them with Chinese. Who's paying for this? American taxpayers, because we're going to pay more, right? If you have a shipyard that's going to build just Navy ships and be idle the rest of the time, right? You're going to pay more than if you use it for both commercial and military purposes. Ask people in shipyards in Mississippi or Maine. Those are the people that are getting hurt by this decision, as well as all of us taxpayers who are paying hundreds of billions of dollars for this giant naval fleet that Senator Lee and President Trump want to spend our tax dollars on. I'll close because there's a lot more that I could have gone, but let's talk a second about some of the winners and losers. A lot has come up about Hawaii. Hawaii is a national median income of $80,000. 2018. Alaska has a national median income of $74,000. Alaska and Hawaii are large net recipients of federal funds for defense and other purposes. They get way more in tax dollars than they get out. Their citizens make a lot of money. Look at some of the communities in Mississippi, where the unemployment among shipbuilders has devastated communities. Look at some of the shipbuilding yards in Newport News, Virginia, in Maine, and ask yourself, who's better off? The former shipbuilders in these shipyards across the American landscape, or the residents in Alaska and Hawaii earning national incomes of 25% or more over the national median? So hopefully I've given some folks a different viewpoint, and I really look forward to engaging in more questions and answers.
Okay, thank you, Aaron. I'm going to now turn to Mackenzie Eaglen to get her perspectives on the Jones Act, the relevance to national defense. And I suspect you're going to talk a little bit about what might be the best policy to ensure that we have adequate national defense. Mackenzie, let me turn the floor over to you.
Great, thank you, and good morning to all of our viewers. Thank you, Vince, for having me a part of this important conversation. Looking at this from a national security perspective, it's very interesting because there's a national security case for repealing the Jones Act, and there are many cases for doing that, and there are many reasons not to do that, or at least not to do it, or at least repeal. And then it has to be replaced with, some parts of it have to be replaced presumably with something. So let me go into a couple of the reasons why that is. So, ironically, we all, Senator Lee, talk about this. We know that it's designed to help in national emergencies or in conflict when the military is mobilizing and sustaining long-term conflict. And strangely enough, the Jones Act is often waived in emergencies. So that's kind of odd. Then why, you know, you have to ask yourself, so then what's it helpful for? So it tends to be more helpful in war than it is in national emergencies like hurricane relief and other times that the military supports domestic response here in America. But, you know, so for example, so let's go back to the during times of conflict. It's also actually been repealed as well in various wars, but not all. But the Defense Department, they need surge sealift capability, right? It's a lot of people and a lot of equipment and a lot of food and a lot of fuel that has to get moved since we project power, right? Because we are protected by two friendly neighbors to the north and the south and two big oceans to the east and the west. So we everything's an away game for the US military. And so everything has to be moved when you need to get somewhere. And we often, we treat our service members pretty well. So very few, you know, pitch a tent and sleep on the ground. They have places to sleep. They have air conditioning, they have internet. All that stuff has to get there and then be sustained. But oilers and tankers in particular are a weak spot for the Defense Department. And not only do they need access to the oilers and tankers for fuel in particular during times of conflict, but they need crew, right? They need trained personnel who know how to do that. So if DOD could access all of the current available military capable tankers, it's still about maybe 3/4 of their requirements. Dr. Krueger was right on the average age, though, and which is another issue, of course. So the average age of all the ships is 45 years old, and that's its own challenge, which gets very expensive very quickly. But I want to talk about the Pentagon's viewpoint on why this matters to its long-term strategy. So Senator Lee talked about, for example, Venezuela and needing to import LNG and other materials for, you know, to heat homes in Maine, and that's true. And we're going to these bad regimes. Well, the Defense Department is top priority is long-term competition with China. That's the defense strategy. The White House has foot stomped that. There's two separate but big issues here relative to China, and Aaron touched on these a little bit. The first is, so if DOD doesn't have access to this surge sealift capability, what you end up doing is you start to rely on foreign flag ships for your sustainment. The Defense Department has already done that. But what we've seen is that many of those foreign flag ships are now flagged by China, as Aaron mentioned. It's built its own fleet of tankers, and they're using them not just for practical purposes, but to influence a portion of the world tanker market through financing, through pooling agreements, and through port management. There's another secondary issue that the Coast Guard has to think about, right? So by preventing, you know, we do want to prevent foreign vessels and crews from sailing in domestic waterways in close proximity to critical infrastructure, like locks, dams, utilities, and refineries. And that's pretty important. So let me give you a couple of stats here. Excuse me while I look down. So we have 95,000 miles of coastline in America, 25,000 miles of navigable waterways, and we have 400 ports. These waterways and facilities are largely maintained by U.S. dredgers. So without the Jones Act requirements, foreign companies can buy domestic carriers that operate smaller vessels and barges that ply rivers, U.S. rivers and intercoastal waterways. We've seen this with toll lanes in Virginia and Maryland, right? The toll lanes, the state has issued 99-year leases where I live and to a foreign company, Transflora in Australia. And you could see this happening with that, as it happens with physical roads that cars go on, as opposed to water roads, which ships and boats use to move cargo and people. So, you know, another think tank here at, in town that I work with pretty closely, the Center for Strategic and Budgetary Assessments, they found that through the Belt and Road Initiative, the Chinese government has slowly but systematically gained port access around the world for commerce, for logistics, and for, yes, naval operations. So I'll conclude with just a couple of points. In March this year, the commander of Southern Command for the Department of Defense, he talked about the growing presence of China in Latin America and the Caribbean. And he said, quote, "I asked myself the question, why would China want to buy an island and lock up a 99-year lease for most of the coast of El Salvador, right here within a two-hour flight of the continental United States? They're trying to achieve positional advantage right here in our neighborhood, and that's alarming and concerning to me, and it drives a sense of urgency with which I look at this competition," as in what I mentioned, the long-term competition with China. So, you know, giving China a foothold in the domestic maritime industry could position the country to disrupt our critical commerce and military readiness. And I think that has to be considered in any scenario, whether it's repeal or refining the Jones Act. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Mackenzie. We now turn to our fourth panelist, Rob Quartel. Rob, what are your perspectives on what Senator Leah said and the other panelists have observed?
Well, I have a number of comments on specific items. I'm always reminded that the Jones Act is a religion, and it stands on a number of pillars, such as defense necessity and so on and so forth. But the facts, of course, belie most of that. I would say the main thing is that I think it's ironic that a 21st century economy and a 21st century military are held hostage to a law written before containerization, before nuclear weapons, before instant warfare, before the internet, before space weapons, before jet planes and aircraft carriers, and before. It failed to prepare us for World War II. And in the seminal sealift event of our lifetime, which was the first Gulf War, it failed utterly. One Jones Act ship was hauled off the beach in Puerto Rico, repaired, it wasn't really a ship, and sent to the war so they could say they participated. Most of the sealift was foreign or US government owned. Almost none was US container ships, which then existed. Today, there are no US container lines doing international trade. They have all been acquired or gone out of business. So it's a law that has failed in everything its supporters claim it has was set out to do, which is to protect shipbuilding, enhance shipbuilding, to help the military projection, sealift projection, to create berths for merchant mariners, and the whole litany. In the fact of the matter is it has destroyed shipbuilding, it's destroyed the US flag fleet, it's destroyed tens of thousands of merchant marine jobs and hundreds of thousands of jobs associated with the industry. It has undercut domestic forest product and mineral production. It's undercut agriculture, as you heard. And in the long term, it has undercut national security. At a political level, it makes liars out of many of our military who know much better than the performance they claim it serves. And it turns politicians into political shills. There's just an awful lot of money in this business. So it's bad policy that actually harms its supporters. But as I say, it's become a religion, and flaws notwithstanding, they somehow cannot extract themselves from the facts on the ground. You know, most critically, in my opinion, it really distracts us from what are real issues. The strategic issue of commerce and China, although China is not the biggest single player. You know, I think they're roughly 10% of shipbuilding and fleets. The US continues to own ships, but they are not flagged in the US for a variety of reasons. But it's bad policy. And what we should actually be looking at is the strategic issues around trade and China, supply chains. You know, we have the issue around COVID as to where our medicines are manufactured and all of that. It undermines national security. What do we really want? Do we need a big commercial fleet, or should the military be paying for it? It undermines readiness. In the most recent activation of ships, the turbo activation, only about 60% of the ships were made ready, and only about 40% actually were got to sail. And the maritime administrator admitted that they were 1,800 jobs short, people short of being able to man a sustained sea lift like the one in the Gulf War some 30 years ago. So in every single respect, it's a failure. And partly that is because this law is 100 years old. And Aaron is correct that it has roots in cabotage back in the 17th and 18th centuries. But one has to ask an economist whether he would like to have an economic system based on that 17th and 18th century principles. But unlike every other country that has cabotage, we are the only one that restricts that to a build component. Many have a flag component. You have to be under that flag in order to sail in their waters and so on and so forth. But in reality, only three tiny countries, I think Bulgaria is one of them, landlocked countries, have a build requirement like the US. And it's the build requirement that undermines everything. Cost of the ships, to the size of the fleet, to the jobs ships used to have. And of course, that's all going to be exacerbated by the advent of technology and automation in shipping, which will be what people do in order to get around the high costs associated with it. So, it's a failure when you look at the actual facts. But this is an argument in which people try to win by distraction and kind of fake facts. So I look forward to the conversation.
Thank you. Thanks, Rob. Now I'm going to ask the panelists if they would like to respond to anything that the other panelists have said in their remarks. I'm going to start with Dr. Krueger. Is there anything that Aaron or Mackenzie have said that you would like to respond to?
Thank you. Yes, there are a couple of things. Mostly I'm in agreement, but a couple of things. One, the requirement, it has to be on American ships with American soldiers because of defense reasons, because we don't want foreigners on our ships because they'd have security access and stuff. We already have foreigners coming into all our seacoast ports. Foreign ships, foreign flag ships come into New Orleans, they come into Houston, they come in on the East Coast and the West Coast. And that argument is what I really worry about, because it seems to me that it is so fallacious. I do think that the whole Jones Act support has come in part because everybody says, well, it's good for the military. And yet, in fact, as was already pointed out, in the Gulf War, not only did we not use Jones Act ships to get the goods over there, the military actually hired foreign vessels for a substantial fraction of the cargo, and for most of the rest of it used its own ships. Very little Jones Act was used, but it was also very little. It wasn't that the military would use foreign ships. So that's the other part. The third thing is that it is more expensive by far to build and stow on here, because it is a cartel or a monopoly that has been put in place by the Jones Act. If indeed you had things more freely open, the same thing would happen here as happened to Europe when they opened up their shipbuilding, which was that, yes, they didn't produce all the kinds of vessels. They produced a few kinds of vessels and imported the others, which gave them much more competitive advantage. I guess that's about all I'd like to say for now, except that South Korea is a much bigger shipbuilder than China and an ally. And therefore, shouldn't be as worried as we are, I think, about China. We should be worried about a healthy industry and cutting our own costs to make our own industries more competitive.
Aaron.
Sure. So I'll say a few things, because I think we're talking past each other. Whether Ann or Rob or Mackenzie and I want to spend $865 billion building 355 naval ships is a different question. Maybe us economists would have a very different military. But the lack of logical consistency between Senator Lee and President Trump's position of spending all this taxpayer money to build all these ships, and then they're more expensive. So we're talking past each other about the usage, et cetera. We probably aren't gonna use all of these ships, right? You know, in the Gulf War, were we using all of our nuclear submarines in all these different aspects? We have them for deterrence, we have them for a lot of purposes. Why do these ships cost so much money to build? Part of it is because we're not building any other commercial ships. We're not doing that because we allow China and South Korea, and it's great, South Korea is an ally, We spend an inordinate amount of money defending them. The president wants to make North Korea an ally too. I don't think we'd want North Korea to be in charge of our shipbuilding capacity, despite what this administration says. So the logical inconsistency on the other side is we prop up this entire shipbuilding industry for the military and then let it sit hollow without building any commercial ships, in part because of the large subsidies in South Korea and China that we have walked away from. If you take the same logic, and I want to ask my fellow panelists this, do you believe foreign aircraft companies should be able to fly US domestic routes? Do you think Emirates Air, which gets large subsidies from the sheikhs and princes of the Middle East, many of whom, and I would agree, Saudi Arabia has been a long ally of the United States, as is Dubai, do we want them running our domestic aviation? Because the logic about the Jones Act is identical to the logic in the aviation sector. We've walled that off. We don't allow foreign competition. Now, we allow foreign flights. I agree with you. We allow an Airbus plane, but we don't allow Emirates Air to run DC to Chicago flights boarding US passengers. Do you guys support that? Because it's the same. And if not, what's the difference in logic?
So one difference, Aaron, I'm sorry to jump in, Vince, is
that— No, that's absolutely.
It's one big difference, and it's the critical difference, is that no airline is required to buy its aircraft in the United States, which has the most competitive industry on the planet. But we can buy them wherever we want. That is the biggest single issue in the Jones Act. I actually am surprised a little bit when I hear you defending the Jones Act. I'm a little surprised that a Brookings economist would support an industrial policy. But well, let me go back. I'm not surprised that a Brookings scholar would support an industrial policy that includes direct subsidies on top of indirect subsidies, that is, a closed market like the Jones Act. But I admit I'm a little bit amused by the indifference to the fact that while all Americans share in the higher price of gasoline, most of the cost of this policy falls on people of color in places like Puerto Rico, Hawaii, and Guam.
On which happy note, let Mackenzie have a few moments here, please. Mackenzie.
Thanks. Not too much to add, but again, it's just the issue is more complex and layered than for just a purely national security lens than I think is even I appreciated before this event. There are reasons that repeal is helpful to the military and there are reasons it's unhelpful. And so I think that has to be worked out. So for example, back to the Navy and some of Aaron's points about shipbuilding. Right, so the Navy could benefit in some ways from a repeal Jones Act because then it could purchase, presumably, cheaper foreign built ships. So in May of last year, the Secretary of the Navy said, I can't afford a lot of $600 million ships. I can't really afford a lot of $400 million ships when I can go out and buy used ro-ros, the roll-on roll-offs, which the military uses for sealift, for $35 to $40 million. That sounds like a steal, relatively, for the Defense Department. So, you know, in some ways, like I said, it can become helpful, but in others, it's different. So what I think the group has to appreciate is, of course, the role of Congress in this, and why is it subsidizing? My former boss, who plays a key role in this, the senator from Maine, the debate about these subsidies for this workforce, and again, separately, the protection of our waterways.
May I just butt in here for a minute, please? Because it seems to me that the problem, the defense argument as it is made, is based on the argument that somehow we have to have all this. Well, first off, I don't think that we could make that argument with the Jones Act as it happened. It seems to me that even repealing the Jones Act would then enable a sensible conversation, both about what the size of the Navy's shipbuilding should be and about the size of the merchant marine. The so-called shipping capacity that's built here is built mostly in barges. It isn't in ships at all.
So I have a couple. I've got to let people who are listening in have at least a little bit of a chance to ask questions. But
I have one quick. Could I one quick response to some of this stuff?
Let the audience ask a question. There's a question from a Mr. Terrell who says, and this may be your question directed to you, Rob, anyway. Why do senators from Alaska and Hawaii often support keeping the Jones Act?
That's a great question, and it comes down to money. So first of all, you have to distinguish between the Merchant Marine Act of 1920, which some people call the Jones Act, but people who actually know shipping call the Merchant Marine Act, and people who know Section 27, which is the actual part to which we most object, which merges the flag requirement, the shipbuilding requirement, and everything else in domestic markets. So when people talk about the Jones Act, most of us really mean Section 27, which is the culprit. Early Alaskans, the law was shepherded by Wesley Jones, who was senator from Washington State, who represented domestic rail and shipping interests. And Alaska at the time was served primarily by Chinese vessels and other foreign vessels that would ship their cargo around the US to a Canadian rail company. And then the rail line would go on up to Alaska in order to get around the law. And so they sort of amended it to tighten it up, so it's no longer US ports, but US places. And it's a little bit of Arcania, but in fact, the law wasn't, this particular section wasn't really written to help shipping, shipbuilding, merchant mariners, or anything else. It was written to help protect Wesley Jones' specific shipping and rail companies in Washington State. And he actually acknowledged that in conversations afterwards. And of course, Alaska has attacked it mildly. But when I years ago tried to set up the Jones Act Reform Coalition and talked to Ted Stevens, Senator Stevens said, it's terrible and you need to do a coalition. And Governor Wally Hickel was part of the coalition. He hated it and so on and so forth. But in the end, Stevens would go up to Alaska and complain about the act. And then he'd go down to Washington State and get money from Tote, which is a Jones Act shipping company. And that is the problem with the system. It's all about money and special interests. And Hawaii is the same way. Senator Inouye, in his own way, both supported independence and in keeping Hawaii in thrall to a company which is really, in which its executives really live in California. So, that's the problem. And actually today, there is a congressman from Hawaii, finally, who has sufficient money to reject the industry. It's Congressman Case, brother of Steve, who actually supports major Jones Act reform. And you know why? It's because he's financially independent. And you can't say that of most congressmen and senators. So that's, I think that's probably Tom Carroll who asked that question.
So, Rob, you're coming back to the crony capitalism argument.
Well, it's that too. But, I would come back to this whole issue of what is it that we really, it diverts our attention from things we really need to do. So, for example, to Mackenzie's point, yes, we need tankers and all of those kinds of ships. And yes, the only place we happen to have those, most of them, is in the commercial fleet. But those ships are not there because of the Jones Act. They're really there because of TAP, the Trans-Alaska Pipeline Act, which required that all that oil move on U.S. vessels, first and foremost. And in the absence of TAP, it probably would have been a much more efficient market and probably fewer environmental damage and other issues that come along with moving oil.
Can I jump in? Because I think Rob and I have agreement on that point, which is that it's not just the Jones Act. It's a series of other laws in its totality called cabotage that are unique in the fields of transportation because of the overlap between defense and commerce, right? You're right that in aviation, people fly on Airbus planes, right? But you're wrong that the Air Force is going to be buying foreign planes, or the U.S. Navy is going to be buying Chinese-built ships or Chinese-built telecom. And there's a great inconsistency between people like Senator Lee and President Trump, who are freaking out about 5G and Chinese-built commercial infrastructure, and then want to go and repeal the remnants that support U.S. manufacturing for U.S. core jobs. One person asked a question about, Robin, and I always know I'm making progress in these things when people start talking about my employer as somehow a reason about my argument. It's part
I'm teasing
of it is
you.
I take it in that, but there's more. There's a reason. You're a smart man who picks his words wisely, and I do the same. And I'm, you know, the average shipbuilding job in America paid $76,000. These are high income jobs. You can fire these people because in China there'll be a subsidy for their thing from the Chinese government, and they'll get paid less, and the ship will be built cheaper, right? And in Korea, they'll get paid less, but there'll be a subsidy from the government. They'll actually come out okay. How much are we paying the unemployed people in Mississippi? How much are we paying as a result of that?
Aaron, I'm going to cut this discussion off there, because that's entirely a different reason. I'm going to make a quick comment. There was a question about if people on average earn higher incomes in Alaska, isn't it because the cost of living there is higher, in part because of the Jones Act? But I want to move away. I want to move away from that discussion. And I want to get to some more questions that the audience have got. And there's a really interesting question, which really is for Mackenzie. As Stephanie Mercier has asked, why has no panelist mentioned the role that the Ready Reserve Fleet plays in preparedness for sea lift capacity for the surges? And you did, but I think this is really a question for Mackenzie.
It's just a lack of time. I can't, it's a good point, and we certainly can talk about that. The challenge here again, though, is the Ready Reserve Fleet isn't often ready, and it's small and it's old and it's expensive. So it's used and it's there and it's helpful, but really the issue, there are two issues here, the fleet and the crew that is ready, trained, their licenses are up to date, they know what to do, and they will volunteer to do it. It's unclear if you would get the response that the Defense Department would need on scale to be able to even man and crew the fleet if required. Another different thing to take in town, my friends over at Cato, they recommended, for example, to address this issue, one way you can solve this is establishing a merchant marine reserve. And so they would receive, periodic training to keep them up to date on new technologies on ships and on the ship's systems that operate it, to obtain any necessary military knowledge and skills, to keep licenses maintained or whatever. And basically, then you can call on, in war or emergency, this crew for government or commercial ships to provide sea lift. And then, if needed, some extra benefits for that service. I think that's actually a smart solution.
I actually proposed that 28 years ago in a Cato article.
Excellent. Probably yours then.
But you're right. I mean, this goes to my point about not talking about what the whole Jones Act argument basically diverts our attention from what are real issues. You're not going to get shipbuilding. If you want to solve shipbuilding, if you want an industry, you're not going to build an industry on the Jones Act and on protectionism. The industry complains, and Aaron noted, that there have been foreign subsidies. Now, the U.S. is the most closed subsidy market, subsidized market on the planet by virtue of not allowing foreign ships into it. That's a huge subsidy. But we were in talks in the mid-80s to eliminate foreign shipbuilding subsidies. And interestingly, and at the time, I headed a high-tech shipbuilding company that had a modular double hull tanker, and we got DARPA money for it and everything else, but we couldn't find a builder who could actually build it in the U.S. The reality is you have to do something entirely different to create a shipbuilding industry. But the U.S. industry essentially vetoed the treaty because it would have eliminated, among other things, Jones Act application of, you know, closed markets. Interestingly, though, the smaller shipyards actually supported it. And the reason they did is because the small shipyards, because they have competition, are actually competitive.
So I've got a, we've got a question for, I think this goes to Anne. In crises, given that the Jones Act is in place and the waivers to the Jones Act seem to be very difficult to acquire, does the Jones Act cost real lives? For example, during Puerto Rico's post-Hurricane Maria situation.
Well, I think there's no, Well, I think there's no doubt that the fact of the Jones Act hurt Puerto Rico in any number of ways, including the very high costs they pay for some of their imported goods, because they have to import almost everything. And of course, the power is dependent on oil, because it's all oil-based, because they've got no hydroelectric in that part of the Caribbean. So given all that, certainly there was damage to the power system, which is, was anyway in bad shape, because of, among other things, because of its high costs and the difficulties with that. In addition, of course, it was also a question of getting supplies to them for relief purposes. And you probably remember that, in fact, finally, after some of the damage and the distress was pointed out and some of the delays in getting any help to them, President Trump finally waived the Jones Act, but he waived it for only 10 days, and you could hardly get very many ships from port in even the Gulf Coast or along the Florida coast to Puerto Rico, because you'd have to load them and get them off and get them there in that time. It was not enough to do good. So I think there's no doubt that the delay in getting relief supplies, the difficulties exacerbated because of the Jones Act and the power company and other things, certainly did cost lives. Whether you could say it cost them directly, I think would be a harder thing to measure. And if anybody's tried to do it, I don't know of it.
Thank you.
Well, let me jump in, because that's wrong. Okay. And it's wrong because there are two different types of ships, as we all know, oil tanker ships and cargo ships. You don't put cargo and humanitarian relief in oil hulls, right? And so there are a bunch of things that happened on this. One, the relief made it to the port. You can look, and anybody here can Google about the thing. The port was stacked and stacked and stacked high with shipped relief goods. The problem was getting the goods brought through the island. So it wasn't a porting problem. Number two, and this was a really weird thing I wrote about it, was this kind of Cato anti-Jones Act sentiment, which has existed probably all 100 years of the Jones Act life, became very popular on liberal social media, that Trump had done this thing in Katrina, but not this in Puerto Rico for the hurricane. And I was moved to write this when I saw this on Facebook feeds of friends of mine who are, you know, not deeply political, not very knowledgeable about the Jones Act of Puerto Rico, very incensed by this administration. And there was kind of a core racial equity component that you did this in when Houston Oil was in play and not here when Puerto Rico was in play. And it all has to do with oil tankers. The waivers that were done in that period were about oil and the refining capacities, et cetera. And these ships are not substitutable goods, as we all know. And so I think a lot of the Puerto Rico anti-Jones Act area, and on this actually, ironically, have been learning about Puerto Rico and the Jones Act my entire life. Per Rob's point about these things being passed on, my mother was an expert in this, actually argued before the U.S. Supreme Court on the application of the Jones Act and Puerto Rico. So I knew kind of instinctively that these ships are not substitutable commodities in terms of oil and cargo. And when you look at the disaster response, getting cargo to the port of Puerto Rico was the least problem.
Aaron, you actually know. Well,
I want to jump in here for at least one person.
Let Anne respond.
Okay, but I have a quick point.
Probably there are many parts to the response, and we don't have 10 hours to take them all in. But having said that, I think most everybody knows the difference between tankers and other ships going in. But the interesting part about Puerto Rico is that they were, at least when I last looked at it, which is 3 or 4 years ago, importing almost all of their oil from Venezuela, because despite the fact that Venezuelan oil was higher cost than Texas oil, the cost of shipping it was enough lower so that, in fact, importing from Venezuela at that time was more cheaper than importing from Texas. It would have been cheaper still, of course, if you could have imported from Texas on international ships, which, of course, would have helped Puerto Rico, and which would have helped, of course, in the after the disaster.
So just on the issue of substitutability, Aaron, you may or may not have followed some of the amusing aspects of the Jones Act supporters, but one of them, they have offered to use oil tankers as grain carrying vessels because they don't have any grain ships. And when the agriculture guys object, which they have a right to, it seems to me, as customers, the argument doesn't, they totally argue substitutability as the reason that there's no difference between a grain carrier and an oil tanker. But that actually, to me, points out one of the big issues, which is an industry that actually does not care at all about its customers. And that is because they have a closed market. It's duopoly markets, and they are no longer regulated effectively. You know, when I was Federal Maritime Commissioner, the FMC had the authority to at least look at competition, and occasionally we'd do it. That was passed off to the Surface Transportation Board, which in theory has a piece of that authority today to regulate the competition, but they have never, ever attack, you know, done anything about it. So this is why I keep saying, this is about, if you had to, the Jones Act is 100 years old, maybe older, if you think of cabotage. It is unique in transportation, not the same as, it's unique on the planet. And it has failed in every respect. So if you want to deal with shipbuilding, how would you do it if you could write it from a clean slate? How would Mackenzie deal with sealift if you could write it from a clean slate? Some of the points you both make about Puerto Rico are true, but not all. You know, Puerto Rico does pay higher prices. Thank God they have absolute access to foreign markets. You know, Mackenzie, I think you mentioned that you don't want Chinese or whomever, or Aaron did, going up the Mississippi. The fact is, there's no law that says they can't, and they do. They go into the lakes, they go into the Mississippi, they go into the rivers and seaways and byways and ports. There's no law that prohibits, and they do it, but they're not everything. We should be trying to figure out how to solve these separate issues.
May I just add one more thing on that, which carries to both points, and that is that there was the question of why did the airplane industry differ and so on in terms of foreign-owned planes being able to fly between American ports. There are a lot of economists who claim that that should be the case. And one of the interesting things to give you a way of comparison is that U.S. air flights were regulated very heavily until the Carter administration. When it became to deregulation, everybody screamed all kinds of terrible things were going to happen. The price of airfare fell dramatically. The number of people flying fell dramatically. And the airlines made more profits. I do not think that it was a case where regulation removal hurt the airlines. And I don't think it would hurt actually the shipbuilding or the shipping industry. I think it indeed would help them to get rid of their monopoly position over the longer term and even over the intermediate term. And if it's short term and there are few high paid workers, and it is few, then of course the simple answer is, okay, we can find a subsidy or we can do something to compensate them in the short term. We don't need to keep the whole country as hostage to those few people.
I've got a 30 second question. Meaning I want the response in 30 seconds from someone. And the question is from Mr. Terrell, a different person. What would the impact be on the Great Lakes shipping system from ending the Jones Act? And maybe, Rob, that's something you would like to respond to.
It's been a long time since I've had to think about the Great Lakes, but there's nothing today that prohibits foreign ships. Canadian ships sail on the lakes and through the St. Lawrence Seaway, and foreign ships are not prohibited from doing it. I would say the main impact of eliminating the Jones Act is that the Great Lakes Fleet, which is in some respects landlocked, would be replenished. It is the oldest fleet of the oldest fleet in this country. There is a laker there that is older than the Jones Act, 103 or 4 years old. And, you know, these guys in the industry say, oh yeah, we can save it, and it's a great ship and blah, blah, blah. But the reality is these ships, as like the Jones Act ships and fleet, so-called fleet itself, less than 100 ships, they are 50 to 100% older than what should be a useful, normal lifetime, a useful, normal, safe lifetime. You know, we saw a ship break in half just a couple of years ago in a storm that was a Jones Act ship. They're too old, they're decrepit. When they tried to get the ready reserve last fall going, the ships on it were so old, many of the sailors had never seen the engines. They were so old. You know, they were steam engines and other stuff that is so archaic. So what would happen if you open the Jones Act, the Great Lakes? Nothing would happen in terms of barges, because we have a robust, competitive barge industry that can compete anywhere on the planet. But the deep draft ships, the larger ships, would be replaced, as well they ought to be, probably by foreign-built ships. That would be the main effect of opening up the foreign
bill. In addition, there would be more freight on those ships, because some of the stuff
Absolutely.
Is never going by rail or by truck that would be shipped to seaborne traffic.
Absolutely. Well, that happened actually when I was with the Jones Act Reform Coalition years ago. The North Carolina farmers wanted to bring grain down from the Midwest. They were absolutely unable to charter a grain carrier or ship to carry the grain through the lakes and on down, and they ended up putting on a rail line is their best way.
So that is, I have one last question, and it's going to be targeted, I think, to Mackenzie. And it's a combination of two questions. If the Jones Act over the last 30 years has had no impact on encouraging domestic shipbuilding, and that's pretty clear. Then this leads to a follow-up. Fundamentally, if the Jones Act really has no impact on military readiness and sea lift capacity, and let's assume that's true, because it does seem that that's the evidence, then Mackenzie, what would be the best path forward, most fundamentally, to ensuring that the armed forces have adequate sea lift capacity for the needs they are likely to face over the next decade?
Good question. I wish it were a blank sheet. As Rob said earlier, to get to some of the goals Aaron disapproves of, but I don't, about the size of the Navy and what it needs to be. It's already too small. Well, excuse me, the Navy and the Coast Guard. I think this should be looked at through a constabulary force lens as opposed to exclusively Defense Department. And there needs to also be partnership with contractor, maritime workers and crews and ships. There's a big private industry out there ready and willing and able to help. You know, it's the Defense Department, what we saw in the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, they didn't have enough air freight capability to move troops and goods. So that we leased Russian cargo jets. We hitched rides with Russia to the space station, or at least we used to. We're constantly relying on others, friendly or not, to help augment the force when needed. The Navy's leadership has talked about how they want a 435 ship Navy because it needs to have a lot of smaller unmanned systems as part of it, as opposed to very expensive, highly technological ships with expensive crew on board. And I think that is how you get at some of the answers here. What are we talking about? What unmanned capabilities are there to support a larger Navy and Coast Guard fleet, even if it's in reserve? And will Congress ever let these two organizations purchase foreign-built ships? It's something that has to be considered. I understand why, on some levels, why they don't. But I think we're past the time that we have to consider that for these lower end capable ships. It's okay if you want to say only US workers build the high tech stuff, but for this other stuff, for just to maintain the movement and flow of goods and people and cargo, why not?
That makes absolute
sense. Can I just jump in?
I have to apologize to everybody. We're at 9:01 and we're overstaying our welcome. All I would like to say is what a fascinating debate, what a lively debate, what an important debate. Thank you to all of the panelists. And even though he's back in Congress doing hopefully the work that we all need him to do, thank you to Senator Lee as well. And with that, thank you to the audience for listening and being patient. And hopefully you found this as engaging as clearly the panelists did. Have a wonderful day.
See you guys. Thank you.
Thank you.